So how likely is it the government will embrace this ACCC recommendation to underwrite investment in new power generation? Well, pretty likely it would seem. The Minister Josh Frydenberg is here in Washington. He told me today they're approaching this fairly favourably. I spoke to him earlier. Josh Frydenberg, thanks very much for your time. Good to see you here in Washington. First question, is the government prepared to underwrite investment in coal-fired power?
Well, we're technology neutral, and so is the ACCC. But what they've identified in this important recommendation, in what is a very comprehensive report, is that there is a market failure, that new entrants into the generation market are struggling to get debt finance because they can only get offtake agreements from large commercial and industrial users for a short period of time, say 5 years, whereas they need offtake agreements for 5, 6, 10, 15 years and from a number of users. So the government is being asked by the ACCC to guarantee a certain price for that generation power as a means to ensure that debt finance can go to the generator.
And you're supportive of the idea?
Well, it's a recommendation. Like all these recommendations,
we'll
probably consult. There's certainly merit in it. And what we would like to see is commercial and industrial users get access to low-cost power, that the system remains stable, and that competition is increased. And they're all the motivations for this particular recommendation.
And to be clear, if implemented, it could see the government underwrite investment in coal-fired power.
Well, as the Prime Minister has said, all forms of power could be available under this scheme, including thermal generation, as well as potentially renewables with storage.
Which is something the National Party is claiming vindication for, but I'm wondering how the states and territories feel about it. I understand you have spoken to them about the idea. What sort of reaction are you getting?
Well, as a courtesy, I called all the state ministers ahead of the release of the report, talked them through the major recommendations. And look, they want to be at the table when we're having this discussion. So the issue of the ACCC's report will be put on the agenda for the upcoming meeting of state and territory energy ministers early on in August. We want to work with the states. We recognise that there are overlapping responsibilities, and indeed some of the areas in which the ACCC have made recommendations are completely the responsibility of the state. So we'll consult with them, we'll consult with the Energy Security Board and other key stakeholders, but ultimately we will always take decisions that are in the consumer's interests with our laser-like focus on reducing power prices.
Just to be clear on this though, none of the states or territories gave you a message that no way would they want you underwriting this sort of investment?
Well, they hadn't obviously read the report. Now they would have had read the report and spoken to the officials. But I have to say, speaking to the states, and we have a very good cooperative relationship going, particularly as we're trying to advance the National Energy Guarantee. They recognise the power prices are too high. They also recognise that the ACCC is our corporate watchdog and that using their compulsory powers to get internal documents, some 50,000 internal documents from the companies, they have put together a very comprehensive report. And as Rod Sims said just last night, that people should support his recommendations if they are determined to ensure better consumer outcomes and lower prices.
So, but you've been telling us the National Energy Guarantee alone would be able to incentivise investment in baseload power and ensure we have enough dispatchable power in the system. Why do we need this additional idea that he's put on the table?
Well, what Rod Sims has identified is a particular market failure, and that relates to the ability of new generators into the system, securing debt finance.
The NEG doesn't cover?
It's complementary to what the NEG is trying to achieve by sending the right market signals about the stability of investment as well as dispatchable power and reducing emissions over time.
I guess cutting to the chase, without this guarantee that Rod Sims has recommended, would power be more expensive?
Well, Rod Sims is saying it would be so.
And you agree?
And I think this report, its recommendations have a lot to commend to themselves to ministers. We'll proceeding very carefully. I'm very favourable about the report. I think the report is good news for consumers, and it's the product of a lot of work, and of course it was commissioned by the federal government.
Now, obviously the federal government has to make a decision on it. Would it then make sense to include this as part of the discussions with the states on the National Energy Guarantee?
Well, the ACCC's recommendations are across the board. They're looking at networks, looking at retail prices, looking at the wholesale market. And, of course, we've got the National Energy Guarantee, which the ACCC has strongly endorsed in this report, which is also welcome. So they're two separate buckets of issues. You've got the National Energy Guarantee, which is being led in terms of the work being done by the Energy Security Board. And, of course, the states do need to sign on to that as part of a cooperative federal-state agreement. At the same time, you've got the recommendations out of the ACCC report, some of which will involve the states, others which don't.
Yeah, but some have expressed concern that any side deal from the government to underwrite investment in coal-fired power might cost their support. So do you need to put the two together?
Well, look, states and the Commonwealth are focused on delivering lower prices. Here we have the corporate watchdog producing a comprehensive report with important recommendations. I think it's required of all of us to give them due consideration.
And National Party MPs, Tony Abbott and other colleagues of yours have been agitating for more support for coal-fired power. Are they right to feel vindicated?
Well, I think we've all been pushing in the same direction, to be honest, which is to ensure that we have the lowest possible price and that we have sufficient, dispatchable, reliable power into the system, whether that is coal, gas, or new forms of intermittent sources of generation. As the Prime Minister pointed out, David, in his speech, under the National Energy Guarantee, coal will still be around 60% of the supply in the market by 2030.
But is this about keeping those pro-coal rebels in line?
Well, this is about delivering lower prices. Like I said, we have a laser-like focus on doing so. That's why we asked the ACCC to get behind the energy company's front door, look inside their businesses, get these internal documents, work out what was going right or wrong in the market, and as a result, they've put forward this comprehensive report.
You've been in Canada, now here in the United States. Can I ask what you're picking up in terms of the energy debates? I mean, how do we compare in Australia? Our power prices seem to be a whole hell of a lot higher than they are here.
Yeah.
Why is that? What are the main reasons why we're paying so much?
Well, every country has a different energy mix. So in Canada, it's overwhelmingly hydro. Here in the United States, it's increasingly gas, and prices are low because of the shale gas revolution and, dare I say it, a more efficient market without some of the missteps that we've made in Australia. When I had dinner recently and spoke at the International Energy Agency and had dinner recently with the head of the IEA, Dr. Fadi Barol, he made the point that of all the countries he's visited, Australia has the most divided and heated debate about energy and climate policy of any country.
In the world?
In the world.
And is that because we pay so much?
Well, we haven't always paid so much, but the fact is in Australia we've had this hyper-partisan debate, and as a result it has created policy uncertainty, and policy uncertainty has meant that prices have become higher than they otherwise should. This is where the National Energy Guarantee is important, and dare I say it, the other reforms that the Turnbull government is leading on, getting more gas into the domestic market before it's exported overseas, reining in the power of the network companies, and of course investing in storage like Snowy 2.0.
Can I ask you, just away from energy, Tony Abbott has given a speech here in Washington today, not on the energy issue, but on Donald Trump's approach to US allies at the moment. He's at NATO, as you know, and he's been quite aggressive in some of his criticism of their defence spending. Tony Abbott says we need to take the message and really boost our defence spending as a US ally well above 2% of GDP, and we need to be more prepared to defend ourselves independently. Is he right?
Well, just like in energy, we inherited a basket case, a real mess.
From Tony Abbott?
No, from the Labor guy. Good try. From the Labor Party when they were in office, because defence spending had got down to its lowest level since 1938. Around 1.5% of GDP. The Turnbull government and before then the Abbott government absolutely focused on putting more money and investment into our defence industry. That is now working. We have a $200 billion plus pipeline of defence spending investment, and that will continue as a trend over time. But we're absolutely committed in all aspects of our military to having our forces equipped with the best possible defence equipment.
Yeah, but he's saying go beyond that, well beyond that. Is this a new front for Tony Abbott to agitate within the government?
I think, you know, if Tony Abbott stood back and saw what the Turnbull government is delivering on defence spending, I think he would give that a tick, because it is certainly a marked improvement on what we'd seen previously under the Labor government.
Josh Frydenberg, good to talk to you. Thank you.
Always.